Today, I've got six of the newest kind of modern lifestyle projectors that are designed to be put in a normal bedroom or living room instead of being confined to a home theater. But the big question is, are any of them good enough to actually replace a TV? In this video, I'm going to test their brightness, contrast, color accuracy, picture quality, audio quality, input lag, smart OS, and advanced features like auto keystone and autofocus to determine which one of these lifestyle projectors is best and if any of them are worth buying. As a reminder, there are no sponsored reviews on this channel, and the specs that I report will be based on my own personal testing rather than just repeating manufacturers' claims. Starting with the least expensive, the XGMI Horizon Pro has an MSRP of $1,699 and a common street price of somewhere around $1,300. The XGMI is the smallest and lightest of all the projectors that we're going to see today, and it runs Android TV 10 as well as having great external connectivity. The XGMI includes four leveling feet, a tripod mount, and if you remove those leveling feet, threaded inserts for a traditional projector ceiling mount. Like all the projectors in this video, the Horizon Pro uses DLP technology with pixel shifting to achieve 4K resolution, but it uses a 3-LED light source, which XGMI claims can generate 2200 ANSI lumens. The XGMI was the runner-up in my last lifestyle projector review, and this unit has been installed in my bedroom for about a year. Next, with an MSRP of $1,799 and a common street price around $1,400, is the projector that was my top overall pick in last year's showdown, and the projector that I've used the most since then, the Dangbei Mars Pro. The Mars Pro has sleek glass and metal construction, but has a much less functional Android TV 9 built in. Fortunately, it has the same great external connectivity as the XGMI, so adding an external streaming stick isn't an issue. The Dangbei has the same mounting options as the XGMI with a standard 1/4-20 tripod mount and four leveling feet that can be removed to use a projector ceiling mount. Unlike the 3-LED light source of the XGMI, the Dangbei uses a single laser light source to produce a claimed 3200 ANSI lumens. After that, we've got a brand new projector from BenQ, the GP500, which has an MSRP of $1,799, and so far the street price matches that number. The BenQ is the largest of all the projectors in this video due to having its power supply mounted inside the projector rather than using an external power brick, and also because it includes an optical zoom lens, which allows more flexibility in placement, both of which are extremely helpful if you plan on ceiling mounting your projector. If you want to put the GP500 on a shelf or table, it also has three adjustable leveling feet and includes four mounting points for a traditional ceiling mount. The GP500 uses BenQ's Android TV 10 streaming stick and also has great external connectivity. The GP500 uses a 4-LED light source, which BenQ says can produce 1500 ANSI lumens. Next is one of the most anticipated projectors of the year with an MSRP of $2,299, but a recent Kickstarter launch that let people buy it early for as low as $1,100. The JMGO N1 Ultra. One very unique feature of the N1 Ultra is its built-in stand, which rotates and tilts for easy aiming onto any wall or ceiling. However, if you want to use a tripod or a traditional ceiling mount, you'll need to buy the purpose-built adapters from JMGO, since it doesn't include mounting points. In addition to running Android 11 and having excellent connectivity, the JMGO uses a brand new triple laser light source designed specifically by JMGO that they claim can produce 4,000 ANSI lumens, while achieving a wider color gamut than projectors that cost 10 times as much and color accuracy that we would expect from studio reference monitors. The JMGO is, on paper, one of the most impressive projectors that's ever been produced if JMGO's claims turn out to be true. After that are two projectors that I saw at CES 2023 that were both supposed to be released internationally sometime this year, but weren't out yet when I started making this video, so I bought the Chinese versions directly off of AliExpress instead. First, with an MSRP of $2,300 listed on AliExpress, but a street price around $1,100, is the Formovie V10 that has a completely different form factor that looks more like an Amazon Echo than a projector. The Formovie V10 runs Fang OS, but unfortunately, since it's the Chinese version, almost all the content is unavailable due to region blocking. But the V10 does have plenty of external connectivity to use whatever streaming stick you want. The V10 uses the same DLP and pixel shifting technology that the rest of the projectors use to produce a 4K resolution, and it has a 3-LED light source which Formovie claims can generate 2500 ANSI lumens. And the most expensive projector in this video, at least based on MSRP, is the Formovie X5, which has an MSRP around $2,400, but a street price around $1,500. The X5 has similar styling to the XGMI, but massively boosted specs. Unfortunately, like the V10, the Formovie X5 is the Chinese region version and uses the same built-in Fang OS, but it has more than enough external connectivity to make up for that. The Formovie X5 also uses DLP and pixel shifting, and similar to the Dangbei, the X5 uses a single laser and a color wheel that Formovie claims can produce an insane 4,500 ANSI lumens, which would make it the brightest projector in this video, and again, we're definitely going to test that. The current standard for measuring projector brightness is the ANSI lumen, which seems like a straightforward measurement. You project an all-white screen, measure the brightness at 9 standard points, average those measurements, and then multiply by the screen size in square meters. The big problem is that projector companies have come up with all kinds of ways to game the system, doing things like using different shades of white, cherry picking only the highest performing prototypes from the production line, and even using special menus and modes that aren't available to the end user to temporarily boost fan power and power to the lasers or LEDs to increase their brightness. These methods may or may not protect them in court since they are loopholes in the ANSI Lumen standard, but in my opinion, and I'm guessing you feel the same way, I feel like the projector that you buy should be able to produce the amount of brightness that was advertised. Starting out with the lowest claimed brightness, the BENQ GP500 claimed 1500 ANSI lumens, and in my test, it produced 1337 ANSI lumens, or around 90% of its claimed brightness. Using those same settings, the BenQ had a 716:1 contrast ratio, which is the difference in brightness between a full white screen and a full black screen. It also had 84% brightness uniformity, which is the difference in the brightest quadrant and the dimmest quadrant. And during my testing, the BenQ's 4 LED light source drew 141 watts of power. Next, with a claimed brightness of 2,200 ANSI lumens, the XGMI Horizon Pro was slightly brighter than the BenQ with 1,395 ANSI lumens, which is around 150 more than the last time I tested it due to some recent firmware updates. But it's still just 63% of its claimed brightness. The XGMI's contrast ratio was less than the BenQ at just 513:1, brightness uniformity was about the same at 84%, and the XGMI Horizon Pro drew 150 watts of power at full brightness. The Formovie V10 claimed 2,500 ANSI lumens, but I was only able to get 1,392 ANSI lumens, which is just 56% of its claimed brightness. On the brightest setting, the contrast ratio was worse than the XGMI at 480:1, brightness uniformity was 80%, and power draw was the highest of any of these projectors at 167 watts. The Dangbei Mars Pro claims its laser light source can produce 3,200 ANSI lumens, but I measured a maximum of 2,063 ANSI lumens, which is the highest yet by a significant margin, but only 64% of its claimed brightness. On that brightest setting, the Dangbei had a contrast ratio similar to the BenQ at 719:1, a brightness uniformity of 89%, and a power draw of 143 watts. Next is the JMGO N1 Ultra with its MALC triple laser light source and 4,000 ANSI lumen claim. I measured the JMGO at 2,657 ANSI lumens, which is really bright, but it's still only 66% of advertised lumens, which to be fair is the second closest to its advertised brightness, only behind the BenQ at 90%. The JMGO also had an extremely impressive contrast ratio at 1593:1, which is more than double the next best projector, the highest brightness uniformity with only a 10% difference between the brightest and dimmest areas, and inexplicably the lowest power draw at only 134 watts. That is crazy. That's a tough act to follow, but Formovie claims that their single laser X5 can produce 4,500 ANSI lumens. Unfortunately, in my testing, I was only able to measure 2,275 ANSI lumens, which is the second highest behind the JMGO and respectably bright, but only 51% of what it advertised. The X5's contrast ratio was also the second highest at 892:1, brightness uniformity was 86%, and the X5 drew 142 watts at full power. That means that the JMGO was the brightest overall by a significant margin, followed by the Formovie X5 and then the Dangbei Mars Pro. And if we're giving bonus points for honesty, the BenQ achieved 90% of its advertised brightness, while the next closest was the JMGO at just 66%, and the Formovie was the least honest at 51% of advertised brightness. I think conceptually everyone has a good idea of what brightness means and how it affects projector performance, but what about color? Specifically, color space coverage and color accuracy are increasingly advertised as major selling points of new projectors. But what does that even mean? This diagram represents all the colors that your eyes can see, but video content is produced in a much smaller subsection of available colors, which we call a color gamut. Standard dynamic range content is mastered in the Rec 709 color space, which is this triangle, while high dynamic range content is mastered in the DCI-P3 color space, which is this significantly larger triangle. And the newest HDR content can utilize an even larger color space called Rec 2020, though for the time being, movie studios are still mastering content in DCI-P3, so Rec 2020 is more about future-proofing. The point is, in general, that the more colors a projector can produce, the more lifelike a projector's image will look. And if you locate a projector's three primary colors, red, green, and blue, on the color spectrum, you can draw a triangle between them, and that triangle will show all the colors that that specific projector can produce. If that triangle includes an entire smaller color space, we would say that it covers 100% or more of that specific color gamut. To that end, JMGO makes some pretty wild claims about the N1 Ultra's ability to produce color, claiming that it can generate colors covering 110% of the Rec 2020 color space, which is that largest triangle. And JMGO says that also corresponds to 210% of the standard Rec. 709 color triangle. To measure those claims, you need a bunch of expensive equipment and software, which I happen to have just bought and spent a month learning to use. So with a Portrait VideoForge 8K signal generator, C6 HDR 2000 colorimeter, and Calman Ultimate software, I measured each of the projector's color gamut on a 100-inch, 1.0 gain screen in a completely ambient light-controlled room. Starting with the JMGO N1 Ultra, since it made the wildest claims. My Calman results showed 100% coverage of the standard Rec. 709 color space, 99.6% coverage of DCI-P3, and an extremely impressive 99.03% of the Rec. 2020 color space, which isn't 110%, but it's still better than basically every TV on the market today. And just for fun, I decided to validate their big Rec. 709 claim using a Rec. 2020 color signal, and I came up with 213% coverage, which is actually even more than the 210% the JMGO claim. As for the other projectors, they all covered at least 93% of the SDR Rec. 709 colors and around 80% of the DCI-P3 color space, with the Dangbei Mars Pro and Formovie X5 performing the worst in both categories. However, being able to produce a wide range of colors is different than color accuracy, which is the ability for the projector to reproduce the same color that the director intended when the video content was mastered. The measurement for this is called the projector's delta E, and Calman can measure it by telling the signal generator to output a specific RGB triplet, and then the colorimeter measures that for accuracy. We would expect a professionally calibrated display to have a delta E below 2, and delta E below 3 is the point where our eyes can't really tell the difference between similar colors. But most TVs from the factory are much less accurate than that, with average delta E values around 10 to 15, depending on which picture settings you use. However, JMGO claims that the N1 Ultra's delta E is below 1, which would basically mean that the projector comes from the factory with colors that are as accurate or more as Hollywood studio monitors, which is another pretty wild claim. Unfortunately, in this test, JMGO came up pretty short, and in its most accurate mode, standard, it had an average delta E in the Rec. 709 color space of 5.56, which isn't terrible at all, but it's definitely not under 1. The BenQ GP500, on the other hand, had an extremely impressive delta E of 1.96, which basically means it comes pre-calibrated from the factory. And the worst performers with the least accurate colors were the Formovie V10 and the Dangbei Mars Pro. So up until now, I've basically just been verifying marketing claims. But the next big question is, does having better brightness, contrast, and color accuracy actually lead to a better viewing experience? I watched high dynamic range and standard dynamic range content on every projector in both a completely ambient light controlled room and with the lights on, and my preferences were pretty surprising based on my earlier testing. First, without question, my two favorite projectors based on my viewing experience alone were the Formovie X5 and the Dangbei Mars Pro, which are both single laser projectors with around 2,000 actual ANSI lumens, which despite having the lowest color space coverage and relatively high delta E values, were absolutely crystal clear, dynamic, vibrant, and had a definite wow factor. Between the two, the X5 had a little bit more color pop, but produced some artifacting and posterization in darker and more blurred sections of the screen, while the Dangbei image was consistently great in both light and dark scenes. I particularly like the way that the Dangbei handles darker scenes using AI picture mode during the day, which sacrifices black levels but greatly improves shadow detail compared to the other projectors, which were significantly less watchable in a room with ambient light. And this is the time that we need to talk about the JMGO N1 Ultra and why I'm gonna have a really hard time recommending it despite its extremely impressive performance specs. The one downfall of the JMGO N1 Ultra is its triple laser light source, which despite being advertised to have dynamic laser speckle reducer technology, produces the worst laser speckle that I have ever seen. Laser speckle is caused because each of the three laser light sources comes from a slightly different point in the array. And unlike diffused LED light, laser light is highly collimated, which makes large diffuse areas of the screen look like they're shimmering. If you've never experienced laser speckle, I originally described it to my wife as looking like the vampire skin from Twilight, but my 10-year-old daughter described it more accurately, saying it looks like when she gets pizza grease on her iPad screen and then moves her head around. My daily use projector is the AWOL LTV3500, which also uses a triple laser light source, and if I absolutely try to notice it, I can see laser speckle in some scenes. But with the JMGO, I can't not notice it, and in some scenes, it's so bad that it looks almost like static or interference on the image. I put in quite a lot of extra time and did a bunch of extra testing on the JMGO N1 Ultra because I really wanted it to be great based on the rest of its specs. But picture adjustments like brightness, contrast, sharpness, and laser light level didn't seem to have any effect on speckle. I also tested it on almost every screen in my house, which includes a 1.5 gain Fresnel ALR screen, a 1.0 gain Silver Ticket gray screen, a 0.8 gain Vivid Storm ALR screen, a 0.8 gain gray outdoor screen, a 1.0 gain textured white golf simulator impact screen, a 0.8 gain CLR2 screen, and I even tested it on a 0.6 gain lenticular CLR screen designed to only be used with ultra short throw projectors. And out of all those, the rougher textured screens like the impact screen and the CLR2 performed the best because they made the speckle less noticeable. In fact, the best results by far came from projecting onto my matte white textured ceiling. So it might be better to use the N1 Ultra in higher ambient light situations where you won't be using a screen. On the complete opposite end of the spectrum, I was surprised how much I enjoyed watching the BenQ GP500, despite its low brightness. In a dark room, once my eyes had adjusted to the light, the amount of detail and realism in the video was unmatched. And it's really a shame that the brightness isn't just a little bit higher to make the highlights pop, because every other aspect of the video quality was spot on. You can see how much closer to the source image the BenQ is than the rest of the projectors, which is the result of that 1.96 delta E value. So if you're into experiencing movies exactly how the director intended it, the GP500 is a great pick. As for the Formovie V10 and XGMe Horizon Pro, the picture quality was just fine. The V10 ended up being a little bit too green in most scenes, and the Horizon Pro was oversaturated in general, but if you weren't comparing them side by side to any of these other projectors or to the source video, I'm sure you'd say it looked great. In fact, I've been using the Horizon Pro in my bedroom for the last year, and every time I fired it up, I was amazed at how good it looked. So in no way am I saying that the V10 or Horizon Pro look bad, they just don't look as good as the Formovie X5 or the Dangbei Mars Pro. However, one of the other reasons that I picked the Horizon Pro for my bedroom projector a year ago was that I didn't plan on installing a separate sound system, and the Horizon Pro had by far the loudest and best sounding speakers of all the projectors in last year's review. However, in this lineup, the Formovie projectors are in a league of their own, with the V10's audio ever so slightly beating out the X5's. Not only do they have virtual surround sound and better bass response while keeping clear vocals, but they're also significantly louder than the rest of the lineup. Here's a short clip from each of the projectors at 50% volume. I put the audio performance of the XGMe significantly lower than the two projectors from Formovie, and then the JMGO very closely behind that. The BenQ was much quieter than the other projectors and didn't have as much low-end presence, but it was still very usable. The Dangbei, to me, had the worst overall sound, focused too much on low-end, to the point where the vocals sounded really muddy. Also on the topic of sound, I measured the fan noise of each of the projectors, and I found that the Formovie V10 was the quietest, around 34 decibels. Then the JMGO at 36 decibels. The Formovie X5 at 37 decibels. The XGMe also at 37 decibels, but at a slightly higher pitch. The Dangbei came in at 39 decibels. And the loudest projector was the BenQ GP500 at 40 decibels.
This is the loudest projector at around 40 dB when measured from this distance, but you can see that's still not very loud.
Next, let's talk gaming, which is one of the best things to do on a big screen. For gaming, there's one measurement that matters more than anything else, and that is input lag. In general, input lag times under 20 milliseconds will satisfy even the most competitive gamers, and anything under 50 milliseconds is going to be indistinguishable for most people. Between 50 milliseconds and 100 milliseconds, things might start feeling a little bit weird, and input lag over 100 milliseconds is unacceptable for most games. I measured input lag using the industry standard Leobotter lag tester that flashes a white box on the screen and measures the time between when it sent the signal and when it arrives at the photodiode on the tester unit. At 4K 60Hz, all the projectors had acceptable input lags under 50 milliseconds, but the BenQ was especially impressive at just 17 milliseconds. And at 1080p 120Hz, the BenQ remained extremely fast while the rest of the projectors flirted with that 50 millisecond number, making the BenQ GP500 the undisputed king for gaming performance. Next, looking at their built-in smart operating systems, the JMGO N1 Ultra is significantly better than the rest, with a pretty full-featured version of Android 11 supporting great new picture adjustments like 11-point white balance, adaptive Luma control, and individual color management. That means that even though the projector didn't come from the factory with a Delta E less than 1 like JMGO claimed, the available controls definitely make it possible to get to that point with proper calibration. Both the BenQ and the XGMI have Android 10, which lacks the advanced picture controls that you find on the JMGO, but the BenQ handles picture settings separate from its SmartOS and has a complete set of color and brightness settings to dial in the picture even further if you wanted. The Dangbei Mars Pro, Formovie X5, and Formovie V10 essentially have zero smart functionality since the Dangbei has an outdated version of Android 9 and the Formovie projectors are using a Chinese region-only OS. For that reason, I'd highly recommend using a streaming stick like the Fire TV Max 4K, which can plug right into the back of the projector and get its power from the built-in USB ports. All these remotes support HDMI CEC, meaning you won't need to have a separate Fire TV remote, and you can still use the same projector remote for any built-in functions that you want to use. Last, let's look at the big difference that makes these lifestyle projectors unique from traditional home theater projectors. I think the manufacturer's vision for these projectors is that you won't permanently be mounting them, but instead you'll travel with them, move them from room to room, or bring them outside whenever you want to have a really high quality movie night. To help with that, they make it as easy as possible to get your screen set up. All you have to do is point the projector at the wall and it will dial in the focus and adjust the corners of the image to give you a perfectly rectangular screen. In my previous videos, the XGMI lineup of projectors have always been the kings of automatic Keystone, but JMGO has really raised the bar here and had near instantaneous and nearly perfect Keystoning for both wall projection and ceiling projection. And the built-in rotating and pivoting stand is a game changer when it comes to easily positioning your screen exactly how you want it. The XGMI Horizon Pro's auto keystone and focus continued to function extremely well, albeit slower than the JMGO. And the Dangbei has received some firmware updates since the last video that significantly increased the accuracy and overall functionality of its auto keystone, though it's still not nearly as good as the XGMI Horizon Pro. The Formovie V10 also performed decently, about the same as the Dangbei, but the Formovie X5 did a pretty poor job in most cases and often complained that the projector was at too much of an angle to use auto keystone. The worst performer here though was the BenQ that just didn't work at all. On the GP500, I would press the auto keystone button and it would act like it was working, but then it would just do nothing. I reached out to BenQ and they did send a replacement unit which fixed the issue, but it is my policy to report anything that happens during my reviews, and my original unit was defective. So overall, this has to be the strangest and most unfortunate conclusion that I have ever come to in a review. The JMGO N1 Ultra is, by far, the best performing projector in this video. It has great brightness and contrast, huge color space coverage, highly adjustable picture and sound controls, speakers with pretty good bass, and a really unique and useful built-in stand combined with great auto keystone functionality. I really want to be able to recommend this projector to you, and I think JMGO did a mostly amazing job designing this machine, but the laser speckle is out of control. If the JMGO ticks all the boxes for you and you're planning on moving your projector around a lot and projecting it onto imperfect textured surfaces like a wall or ceiling in a room with high ambient light, then the JMGO might be the right choice for you still. However, I would not recommend it for use with a screen because for me at least, the speckle from the JMGO's triple laser light source is a constant distraction. On the other hand, both of the single laser projectors were fantastic, but the Formovie X5 was easily my top overall pick out of these six projectors. Compared to the Dangbei Mars Pro, the Formovie X5 had louder, higher quality speakers, higher brightness, lower input lag, and lower fan noise. So as a standalone living room or bedroom projector, the X5 is the clear choice. The other piece of good news for you is that the X5 recently just went on sale on Amazon and projectorscreen.com, so it's no longer necessary to import it directly from China. But it does still ship with the Chinese version of Fang OS, so you'll need to pick up a good streaming stick like the Fire TV Max. The Dangbei, which was my overall top pick in last year's video, still holds up and can occasionally be found online for $1,250 on sale, which is a steal and makes it a very viable option over the X5, especially if you're planning on using a separate sound system. As for the BenQ GP500, it is completely consistent with the quality and color accuracy that I've come to expect from BenQ. And if it were 500 lumens brighter, I think it might have been my top pick. As it stands, the BenQ is a great option for gamers with its super low input lag and cinephiles who want to experience movies as they were intended by the director with its delta E of 1.96. But the GP500 is only suitable in light controlled environments due to its significantly lower brightness than the Dangbei Mars Pro, Formovie X5, and JMGO N1 Ultra. I've got links to all the projectors from this video down in the description, and if you appreciate the time, effort, and money that it takes me to make a video like this, I'd appreciate if you could use those links since I do earn a small commission on the sale at no cost to you. I'd also like to thank all of my awesome patrons over at Patreon for their continued support of my channel, and if you're interested in supporting my channel, please check out the links down in the description. If you enjoyed this video, go ahead and hit that thumbs up button and consider subscribing. And as always, thanks for watching The Hookup.